start with my presentation on Delaware Grammar Recovery and Critical Writing Function with Ken Dennis. So the research question that I was looking at here is that when we have Ken Dennis, you've got adaptive tests that are delivered to a live audience. You've got a sparse data set. It's non-random, and it's really usually a pretty small subset of the item-based group. So we've got, let's say, an item pool of 200 items, and every student's only seeing 20 or 40 or 60 items out of that pool of 200, and it's a very non-randomly selected one. In fact, it's got some severe weight restriction, because the smart people on the top end of the distribution are only seeing the top items for the most part, except for a few middle items, obviously, that are really good. So we've got this really poor data set. One of my clients asked, well, we're still interested in looking for primary grip and differential item work. Can we actually look at the data set to see if there were any results? And I said, conventional wisdom says no, because the data set is too sparse and it's not random, you won't be able to tell if there's IRC effectively. But I said, it's a good question. So let me create some data sets to find out, see if we can actually find it, even when we're able to share, because I'm looking at their data set because there. So what we want to do here is figure out whether if having this range restriction problem affects the parameter estimation as well as the depth, and also if we can do certain things to alleviate that issue if there is any information. So I was looking for three things, or three specific questions that I was evaluating. First was, can we recover the visual item parameters? And was, can we find differential item function, if differential item function is actually there? And third, I can find primary grip and differential item. So I did a little bit of a preliminary review, and what was out there wasn't too frustrating. This one in the paper 2012 on the parameter recovery was acceptable with biological parse scale, but they took cat data and calibrated it to biological parse scale. We found that they were able to get their original parameters back pretty closely. The bias was pretty small, you see there. And Harms et al. Did the same kind of thing, also found very small issues, but found some regressions to the mean. It seems like the average mean was, they could say it was 0.6, and when they recalibrated, the average mean came down by 0.6. It was noticeable enough that you could see it in the results there. As for differential item functioning, Rebecca Zwick looked at panel handful statistics, trying to find different gap and those items. We didn't find too much, and Gonzalez Pentos did a similar thing, but they were looking at the cat item, they were looking at pretest items. So they were delivering a cat item, they had a block of new pretest items that were randomly delivered afterwards. So that had non-random data, there was no range restriction in that data. So she was able to find differential item function, especially in examples. But this wasn't the question that I was trying to answer. It's like looking at cat data to find it. And then lastly, I was looking for parameters to grip. And I didn't find any research studies that use a Monte Carlo approach. I found some that were looking at actual real data. But again, they didn't know if there was grip. They just looked at real data to see if there was a difference. They didn't find any. So my goal was to do a Monte Carlo research design where I crafted data sets that did have different drift that I wanted to find, and then check to see if I did actually find it to the extent that I did it. And I did it using simulcast. Chris Hahn is the author of simulcast. He's actually at the time of the and it's got some nice different drift functionality already built in, but as you can run cat simulations in the software and say, I want the first 5,000 people to have GIF, the first 5,000 people that have GIF, and GIF will do that for you. And then, so I created these data sets using simulcast, and then I calibrated them with Scalper, which is my company that has calibration software, to see if then I can find any differences in results. The research design that I used was inspired by the client that brought up this question. I tried to match their real life as possible, because it not only is answering questions for them, but set for media parameter 0.8, the mean media is about 0, came out to actually be minus 0.7, and we see parameter 0.2 because this client uses a bilateral for questions. And then I generated 10,000 exam means on the normal distribution, and simulated the cap score, 10,000 exam means, surveyed the relations. So there were three independent variables that I focused on. The first one was the parameter coverage. So are you able to recover the original IRT parameters? First, I did it using, as a baseline, 150 items fixed cap. Because, you know, the big, 200 items, 150 items fixed cap, it would be pretty much gigantic, not very sparse matrix. So it's a best-case scenario for when you get used to cover the parameters. Then I did 30 item, or 0.3 SEM termination with a 40 item max, and 0.3 SEM termination criterion with a 40 item max, plus 5 item random S exposure. The reason I did that, again, was because this is what the client uses. So it wasn't just an arbitrary choice that's coming back, what they're going to use. So the goal here is that I would hope the latter two would turn out as well as the first one. So that first one is baseline. Then I was checking to see if we calibrate the data from the 40 item max, select the max of those items, so actually be shorter. Do the parameter recovery estimates come out as well as the first one? And secondly, does the random S improve the calibration? Because theoretically, if you're implementing more randomness in your item selection, you're going to have less of that range of selection problems because people are going to be aligned or spread and things like that. The second independent variable is the different item function. So for this one, I took that cap of the 40 item max with the 0.3 SEM and put in three conditions looking for differential item function. I created a differential item function with a minority of 2,000 under the 10,000 and then a 50-50 split of the samples. This finding is a pretty fine fact, even if there's a minority, like what's the minority in 10% of the population, or you can find it. And then I had two levels of diff extent, that is, differential item function differs with d by 0.5 or by 0.5, which is pretty significant jump. And that's applied to 40 out of the 200 items. So I took randomly picked 40 out of the 200 and said, I'm going to consider these 40 items to be biased items that have different weather function shift of 0.5 for one of the students. And then again, I still have randomness exposure as a part of the people. And then thirdly, I was looking for drift. So again, I was looking at 40 randomly selected items, but instead of just applying different weather function shift, I applied drift that is going to change the responses for everybody. Now, what it means by implementing different drift in this case, you can sign it as that it's going to use the original item parameters to select the items, the item selection condition or information that you're using. But when it's generating the responses for the Monte Carlo simulation, it's going to use the new item parameters. That is, what if the item was compromised? It's going to look a lot easier for the subgroup. So it's going to use those new parameters that make it look easier for the generated responses. But to use old parameters, we can do that selection. So what kind of results did I have? Well, first of all, let's look at the parameter recovery. So first, I looked at, in terms of dependent variables, total difference, that is the average difference between the old parameter and the new parameter, as well as the average absolute difference. So you can see if there's a sign difference. In terms of sign difference, you can see there are separately some sign differences. That's the left side of the table. And that's, there was bias when you're trying to calibrate the cat data. And in terms of how big that bias is, that's most evident on the right side. There wasn't much difference for the A and the C parameters. But the B parameters, you can see that this box and this box were about double what this box is. So that means that the parameter estimates we were getting out of the CAT data were about half as good as it was in that 150 item baseline. So the gap is fairly robust in that these, if you think about the B parameter going from minus 3 to plus 3, being off by 0.19 or being off by 0.4 is not that big of a deal. It's noticeable, but it's not huge. But it's still definitely more than it was if you're calculating better. determines that parameter is two relatively close edges. So here's a fiber, it's going to plot of old versus new idle parameters. So the blue dots here are the 150 baseline, and they're kind of on the ending line as you would expect, but with a slight shift up, because it doesn't go through the origin, it goes to the bottom origin. That's that slight bias that I found. Nice straight line to the blue, fairly straight line to the gray, and then the green ones were a lot, for the orange, excuse me, were a lot more spread around. That's the more the top of the exposure. The gray ones had some random aspect exposure reflection up a little bit better. That's the first research question. The second research question was looking for differential idle function. So, like I said earlier, there were 8 different cases here by crossing the number of n, the dip, which is minority like small, which is half the population. How big is your shift in dip, and what's your exposure control? And I was looking for here the proportion of items that were flagged for differential idle function in the Excalibur, which uses the mental density here that is with us. And what I'm finding here is that, so these are the items that actually have dip, what proportions were flagged for those? And yet without dip, what proportions were flagged for those? You can see, for sure, these proportions were higher than the mean proportions. So they're flagging more dip items that were actually created to have bias, than the items that were created not to have bias. But the disturbing thing here was that, obviously, there's a good number of false positives on this one. And on Hensel's flagging items that are biased, and they don't actually have bias. And this was pretty disturbing, too, is that in no case did we find half the items that had bias when they actually had. So even though I created a fairly strong bias situation here and made it fairly easy to find, but it's got half the population, the mental hygiene procedure wasn't good. So this doesn't bode well at all for using mental hygiene finding that we had that. Actually, probably should have done it with non-tech data too, because it wasn't very good. Now, it's a different story with the drift analysis. So there are 4 cases here, as well as that 150 baseline, which I included. So that 150 baseline didn't actually have drift, but I checked to see if I could find anything on those 40 items. So again, there's a slight bias in the recalibration of the parameters. So you see they shift down by about 0.1 on the B scale. And then the bias was about 0.15 and 0.18 positive when there was 0.25 drift, it was 0.4 or so bias when it was 0.5 drift. Now, the cool thing is that the baseline had that negative 0.1 shift, and you add it to those numbers here, that comes out to be just about the exact drift that I could use in the first place. So these two items had about 0.25 drift, and if you take 0.1 plus 0.18 comes to 0.28, and 0.1 plus 0.15 comes to 0.25, we found about the exact amount of drift that we should have found. So it says that even if you have this really sparse cat data, it bodes well that you probably won't find drift if there is drift. But you're probably not going to find dip. So that could be due to the mental health procedure, not to the fact that dip is undetectable. So the conclusions here, like I said, can cat be data be recalibrated? For sure. But you might find small shifts in the scale, so careful about that. I'm not sure if that's regression to the mean. In this case, it wasn't. It might be minus 0, so you know it's minus 0.1, so it got away from 2. That's another reason question to figure out what's going on there. Can we find dip? You know, that at least not for the mana cancel. Might be worth looking at fundamental indices. But can we find drift? Absolutely. So it's definitely worth looking for representation. What else is there to examine? This one's pretty small study in complexity. You do your master's thesis or dissertation on this topic, even in way more situations than actuality. I'm just trying to answer these two very specific questions in the case of the examples that my client is working with. But I think this would be a pretty interesting research study to expand these to more further evaluate what actually goes
Yeah, because, you know, for
Real life, it won't look like
If you have a client, who cares about it?
Yeah. But I think, because the client probably wouldn't care about it too, but I think most likely for them, I know they have a different kind of state of
But that landfill, there's, I don't think we're going to find a way to use it. The developers are a good part.
Yeah, certainly better than nothing. Clients, 40% of them give a strong, most of the best of their own.
Okay.
So. But we need another, I'm going to go, but recalibration thing. Another thing I'd like to look at is, doing this is like, this is the truth of that, we've got these shorted items. Let's take 10 or 20% of those, fix the other parameters, and get the changes, calibrate the rest, and see if that allows us to have better power to find the way to do it. Awesome.
Yeah.